Okay, so I'll present our joint work with Dmitry Podoprych, Timur Garipov, Dmitry Vetrov, and Andrew Gordon-Wilson. Averaging weights leads to wider optima and better generalization. In this talk, the concept of optimal weights, as in previous talk, would play a really important role. Sorry about that. So let's quickly review this concept. And in deep learning, width is conjectured to be highly correlated with generalization. And the high-level idea for why this is illustrated here in the slide. So here, the green curve is illustrating the train loss surface. And the blue curve is showing the test error surface. And as we can see, even though sharp optima can appear to perform very well on train, when we project them to the test error surface, the performance can degrade substantially. And on the other hand, wider optima are more robust to this small horizontal shift between train and test distributions. And we will revisit this intuition later in the talk. So in this work, we propose stochastic weight averaging, which is a new technique for training deep neural networks. And the main idea for SWA is to maintain a running average of the weights traversed by SGD with a modified learning rate schedule. And the way we modify the learning rate schedule is to make sure that SGD doesn't just simply converge to a single solution, but continues to explore the set of high-performing networks. The high-level idea of averaging was explored in previous literature on convex optimization with more focus on convergence rates. And it was also somewhat explored in deep learning with exponentially weighted averages, but there people didn't use to modify the learning rate schedule. And so the general observation was that it improves the smoothness of convergence and also sometimes convergence rates, but not generally generalization. And on the other hand, SWA consistently improves generalization on a wide range of benchmarks. It also has almost no computational overhead compared to conventional training, and it's extremely easy to implement and use. In this talk, we'll also show some of the explanations for why SWA works. We'll demonstrate that it finds wider solutions than conventional training, and we'll show that it approximates ensemble of the networks for which we average weights. So throughout the talk, we'll often need to visualize the trajectories of SGD in the weight space. And the way we are going to do this is we fix three networks that are shown here with crosses in the slide. And we'll consider the two-dimensional plane consisting of all the affine combinations of these three networks. So basically, we are selecting a two-dimensional plane that is passing through these three networks in the weight space. And we then visualize the train loss and test error restricted to this two-dimensional plane. So in this slide, we do the following experiment. We first start from a pre-trained solution with conventional training, and from there we run SGD with a fairly high constant learning rate. And what we can observe is that SGD will keep bouncing from the walls of the train loss and stay at roughly the same value of the train loss. Another important intuition is that if we average the iterates by symmetry, we are getting inside a high quality region. So averaging this SGD iterates produced with the same constant high learning rate, we are going to be able to get fairly high generalization. And another important thing that we can notice in the slide is that there exists this small shift between train and test distribution. But we'll see more extreme cases of this shift later in the talk. So why do we observe this behavior that SGD doesn't go to a minimum, but instead jumps around an optimum? In the literature, it was shown that under some simplifying assumptions, SGD can be thought of sampling from a high-dimensional Gaussian distribution. And we know that high-dimensional Gaussian distributions have most of their samples concentrated in a thin shell around an ellipsoid of constant density. So we should expect SGD to actually move on the surface of this ellipsoid and at roughly the same level of train loss. But averaging, so this ellipsoid reminds the soap bubble. And averaging the iterates, we can get inside the soap bubble. And that's one of the intuitions for our SWA approach. But a natural question to ask here is, why is it better than just decreasing the learning rate? Because that would also allow us to get inside this bubble. So in order to address this question, we consider cyclical learning rate schedule instead of the constant learning rate in the previous slide. So the idea for cyclical learning rates is that when the learning rate is high, the method is traveling fairly quickly in the wave space, but as the learning rate decreases, we can get networks that perform roughly as good as you would get if you trained the network the usual way. So it allows us to find multiple networks that perform quite well on test, but that are also meaningfully different. And here we show the trajectory of SGD with the cyclical learning rate schedule. So as you can see, first of all, the trajectory is now much closer to an optimum than it was for the constant learning rate, which is expected. But a surprising thing here is that the iterates are still only at the boundary of the good solution in terms of test error, and that averaging them, we can actually still substantially improve the performance. And this experiment serves as the main intuition for our SWA approach. So to provide you with some context for how we discovered SWA is we originally explored an ensembling approach that would run SGD with the cyclical learning rate schedule and then average the predictions of the networks corresponding to the minimum values of the learning rate. And then we visualized the trajectory of SGD with the cyclical learning rate, much like what you see here in the slide. And we've seen that averaging weights would also improve performance similarly to averaging predictions. And we believe that one of the main reasons for that is actually that it approximates ensembling, in the sense that the weights that we average in SWA are actually quite close to each other in the weight space. And we can apply a simple linearization argument to show that in this case, the predictions of the network with average weights would be close to the average of predictions of those networks for which we average weights. And in the paper, we actually test this empirically and show that this is indeed the case. So SWA approximates an ensemble of the networks for which we average weights. So now I'll discuss the details of our approach. First of all, we need to run SGD with a modified learning rate schedule. And the way we modify it is for the first roughly 75% of available time, we run SGD as usual. But from there, we run either a cyclical or a constant learning rate, because we want the method to continue exploring this set of good solutions, as we've seen in the beginning of the talk. Because suppose we decrease the learning rate to approximately zero, then the steps of the method become too small, and when we average them, we get approximately just the last iterate of SGD, and there is no benefit from averaging. So we use either a cyclical or a constant learning rate. And for the cyclical learning rate, we average weights that are attained by SGD in the end of every cycle of the learning rate. And for the constant learning rate, we average weights just in the end of each pass over the training data, or in the end of each epoch. And then we in the end of training, we reset the weights of our network to these collected averages, and we use them for new test objects. But there is one last detail that we have to take care of, and that's batch normalization. So if our network contains batch normalization, then in order to apply it to new test objects, we need to find the statistics of activations first, the running mean and average of and standard deviation of activations. And the way we do that is we, after the training is finished, we do one more pass on the training set using this average weights and just compute the activation statistics. And in most deep learning frameworks like PyTorch or TensorFlow, you can just set the network in the training mode and compute the predictions for that network on every object in your dataset. So now let's look at some empirical results for SWA. Here we, as well as for every other figure in this talk, we are using ResNet 164. On C400. And what we do here is we pretrain the network for 125 epochs, and from there we run SGD for another 25 epochs as usual to get the SGD solution, but we also restart and run SWA from there for the same amount of time. And we visualize the train loss and test error surface in the plane containing these three points. And what we observe is that SGD finds a solution that's better in terms of train loss, but SWA is substantially better in terms of test error. And what this implies in particular is that there exists this substantial shift between train and test, and that SGD suffers from it. So in order to better understand what's going on in this slide, we plot the train loss and test error along the one-dimensional line connecting SGD and SWA solutions. And what we see is actually an empirical realization of the conceptual figure that I showed you in the beginning of the talk. So here, the blue line represents test error surface, and the green line shows train error, train loss. And as we can see, the SGD solution that is shown with the square is quite good on train, but it also lies near the boundary of the set of good solutions. And because the train loss and test error are not perfectly aligned, the performance of SGD on test error is strongly suboptimal. But SWA, on the other hand, it's not exactly optimal in terms of train loss, but it lies in a really wide region of train loss. And when we project it to the test error surface, it performs very well. So now, in order to further understand the widths of SWA and SGD solutions, we analyze the behavior of train loss and test error as we move away from these solutions in random directions in the weight space. So what you see here is, for example, for each blue line, we select a random ray starting from SWA solution, and we track how test error increases as we go away from this from SWA solution along this direction. And what we can see here is that SWA not only performs better on test, but it's also substantially wider than the SGD solution in this particular sense. And what's more interesting is that while SGD is actually better on train, SWA is still wider, which corresponds to our intuition about the correlation between widths and generalization. So now let's very quickly discuss some of the numerical results. So we applied SWA to a bunch of computer vision tasks on a range of architectures, and we've consistently seen substantial improvements at pretty much no additional cost. But what's even more exciting is if we have additional time, we can run SWA a little bit longer and improve results even further. So here in the last column, you see the results when we run SWA for 1.5 time as long as it normally takes to train the network with SGD, and we get even better results. And the improvements we see here are particularly exciting given the level of accuracies that we are working with here. So we see consistent improvements for networks like wireless nets, pyramid nets, shakes, and dense nets. So in subsequent literature, in subsequent work, we also considered some applications and extensions of SWA. So there are two papers presented at the Uncertainty in Deep Learning workshop tomorrow. In the first, we apply SWA to actor-critic methods in deep reinforcement learning, and we see consistent improvement both in terms of training stability and in terms of final cumulative, average cumulative rewards that we get. And we also, in the other paper that appears as a contributed talk tomorrow, we considered an approach, an ensembling approach based on SWA that allows us to substantially improve uncertainty quantification in deep neural networks. And in another paper with Bennett Radkun, Mark Finzi, and Andrew Gordon Wilson, we considered a modified version of SWA and applied it to consistency-based semi-supervised learning methods. And just applying it, we could break world record results on pretty much every semi-supervised learning problem that we attempted. So to sum up, SWA is conceptually a very simple technique, but it's also very powerful, and it improves performance on a wide range of applications, including supervised learning, semi-supervised learning, reinforcement learning. And it's also extremely easy to implement and use, and we also provide code. So we encourage everybody to try it for yourself and see if it helps with your applications. Thank you.